I was the shadow of the wax wing slain by the false azure and the window pane. I was the smudge of ash and fluff, and I lived on, flew on in the reflected sky. And from the inside too, I duplicate myself, my lamp, an apple on a plate. Uncurtaining the night, I'd let dark glass hang all the furniture above the grass. And how delightful when a fall of snow covered my glimpse of lawn and reached up so as to make chair and bed exactly stand upon that snow out in that crystal land. Retake the falling snow, each drifting flake, shapeless and slow, unsteady and opaque, a dull dark white against the day's pale white, in abstract larches in the neutral light, and then the gradual and dual blue, as night unites the viewer and the view, and in the morning diamonds of frost express amazement whose spurred feet have crossed from left to right the blank page of the road, reading from left to right in winter's code. A dot, an arrow pointing back, repeat. Dot, arrow pointing back, a pheasant's feet. Torquated beauty, subliminated grouse, finding your china right behind my house. Was he in Sherlock Holmes, the fellow whose tracks pointed back when he reversed his shoes? All colors made me happy, even gray. My eyes were such that literally they took photographs whenever I'd permit, or with a silent shiver, order it. Whatever in my field of vision dwelt, an indoor scene, hickory leaves, this felt, stilettos of frozen still aside, was printed on my eyelids neither side, where it would tarry for an hour or two. And while this lasted, all I had to do was close my eyes to reproduce the leaves, or indoor scene, or trophies of the eaves. I cannot understand why from the lake I could make out our front porch when I take lake road to school, whilst now, although no tree has intervened, I look but fail to see even the roof. Maybe some quirk in space has caused a fold or furrow to displace the fragile vista, the frame house between Goldsworth and Wordsmith on its square of green. I had a favorite young shagbark there, with ample dark jade leaves and a black spare, vermiculated trunk. The setting sun bronzed the black bark around which, like undone garlands, the shadow of the foliage fell. It is now stout and rough, it has done well. White butterflies turn lavender as they pass through its shade, or gently seem to sway the phantom of my little daughter's swing. The house itself is much the same, one wing we've had revamped. There's a solarium, there's a picture window flanked with fancy chairs. TV's huge paperclip now shines instead of the stiff vein so often visited by the naive, the gauzy mockingbird, retelling all the programs she had to heard, switching from chippo chipper to a clear, to wee, then rasping out come here, come here, come here, flirting her tail aloft, or gracefully indulging in a soft, upward hop-flop, and instantly to wee, returning to her perch, the new TV. I was an infant when my parents died. They are both ornithologists, I've tried so often to evoke them that today I had 1,000 parents. Sadly, they dissolve in their own virtues and recede, but certain words, chance words I hear or read, such as bad heart, always to him refer, and cancer of the pancreas to her. A preterist, one who collects cold nests. Here was my bedroom, now reserved for guests, here tucked away by the Canadian maid. I listened to the buzz downstairs and prayed for everybody to always wail. Uncles and aunts, the maid, her niece Adele, who'd seen the Pope, people and books and God. I was brought up by dear, bizarre Aunt Maud, a poet and a painter with a taste for realistic objects interlaced with grotesque growths and images of doom. She lived to hear the next babe cry, her room we've kept intact. Its trivia create a still life in her style, the paperweight of convex glass enclosing a lagoon. The verse book open at the index, moon, moonrise, more, moral, the forlorn guitar, the human skull, and from the local star, a curio. Red Sox beat Yanks 5-4, on Chapman's homer, thumbtacked to the door. My God died young, deletery I found, degrading in its premises unsound. No free man needs a god, but was I free? How fully I felt nature glued to me, how my childish palate loved the taste, half fish, half money, of the golden paste. My picture book was at an early age, the painted parchment paper in her cage, mauve rings around the moon, blood orange sun, twinned iris, and that rare phenomenon, the auroral, when beautiful and strange in a bright sky above a mountain range. One opal cloudlet in an oval form reflects the rainbow of a thunderstorm, which in a distant valley has been staged, for we are at most artistically caged. And there, the wall of sound, the nightly wall, raised by a trillion crickets in the fall, impenetrable, halfway up the hill, at Paul's enthrall of their delirious trill. That's Dr. Sutton's light, that's the Great Bear. 1,000 years ago, 5 minutes were equal to 40 ounces of fine sand. Outstare the stars, infinite foretime and infinite aftertime above your head. They close like giant wings, and you are dead. The regular vulgarian, I dare say, is happier. He sees the Milky Way only when making water. Then, as now, I walked at my own risk, whipped by the bow, tripped by the stump. Asthmatic, lame, and fat, I never bounced a ball or swung a bat. I was the shadow of the wax wing slain, by feigned remoteness in the windowpane. I had a brain, 5 senses, 1 unique. But otherwise, I was a cloudish freak. In sleeping dreams, I played with other chaps, but really envied nothing, save, perhaps, the miracle of a lemon slate left upon wet sand by nonchalantly deft bicycle tires. A thread of subtle pain, tugged at by playful death, released again, but always present, ran through me. One day, when I just turned 11, as I lay prone on the floor and watched a clockwork toy, a tin wheelbarrow pushed by a tin boy, bypass chair legs and stray beneath the bed, there was a sudden sunburst in my head. And then, black night, that blackness was sublime. I felt distributed through space and time. 1 foot upon a mountaintop, 1 hand under the pebbles of a panting strand, 1 ear in Italy, 1 eye in Spain, in caves my blood and in the stars my brain. There were dull throbs in the Triassic, green, optical spots in upper Pleistocene, an icy shiver down my age of stone, and all tomorrows in my funny bone. During 1 winter every afternoon, I'd sink into that momentary swoon, and then it ceased. Its memory grew dim, my health improved, I even learned to swim, and like some little lad forced by a wench, with his pure tongue, her abject thirst to quench, I was corrupted, terrified, lured. And though old Dr. Colt pronounced me cured of what he said were mainly growing pains, the wonder lingers and the shame remains. There was a time in my demented youth when somehow I suspected that the truth about survival after death was known to every human being. I alone knew nothing, and a great conspiracy of books and people hid the truth from me. There was the day when I began to doubt man's sanity. How could you live without knowing for sure what's dawn? What death, what doom, awaited consciousness beyond the tomb. And finally, there was the sleepless night, when I decided to explore and fight the foul, the inadmissible abyss, devoting all my twisted life to this one task. Today I'm 61. Wax wings are berry pecking, a cicada sings. The little scissors I am holding are a dazzling synthesis of sun and star. I stand before the window and I pair, my fingernails vaguely am aware of certain flinching likenessness. The thumb, a grocer's sun, the index lean and glum, college astronomer, star over blue. The middle fellow, a tall priest I knew, the feminine fourth finger, an old flirt, and little pinky clinging to her skirt, and I make mouths as I snip off the thin strips of what Aunt Maud used to call scarf skin. Maud's shade was 80 when a sudden hush fell on her life. We saw the angry flush and torsion, a paralysis assail her noble cheek. We moved her to Pinedale, famed for its sanitarium. There she'd sit in the glassed sun and watch the fly that lit upon her dress and then upon her wrist. Her mind kept fading in the growing mist. She still could speak. She paused and groped and found what seemed at first a serviceable sound. But from adjacent cells, impostors took the place of words she needed, and her look felt imploration as she sought in vain to reason with the monsters in her brain. What moment in the gradual decay does resurrection choose? What year? What day? Who has the stopwatch? Who rewinds the tape? or some less lucky will do all escape. A syllogism, other men die, but I am not another, therefore I'll not die. Space is a swarming in the eyes of time, a stinging in the ears. In this hive I'm in, locked up, yet if prior to life we had been able to imagine life, what mad, impossible, unutterably weird, wonderful nonsense it might have appeared. So why join in the vulgar laughter? Why scorn a hereafter none can verify? The Turk's delight, the future lyre's the talks, with Socrates and Proust and Cyprus walks. The seraph with his six flamingo wings, and Flemish hells and porcupines and things. It isn't that we dream too all the dream. The trouble is that we do not make it seem sufficiently unlikely, for the most we can think of is a domestic ghost. How ludicrous these efforts to translate into one's private tongue a public fate. Instead of poetry, divinely terse, disappointed notes, insomnia's mean verse. Life is a message scribbled in the dark, anonymous, espied on a pine's bark. As we were walking home the day she died, an empty emerald case squat in for our guide, hugging the trunk in its companion piece, a gumlog ant, that Englishman in Nice, a proud and happy linguist, Genois, le prostisca, meaning that he fed the poor seagulls. La Fontaine was wrong, dead is the mandible, live the song, and so I pare my nails and muse and hear your steps upstairs and all is right, my dear. Sybil, throughout our high school days I knew your loveliness, but fell in love with you during an outing of the senior class to New Y Falls. We luncheon on damp grass. Our teacher of geology discussed the cataract, its roar and rainbow dust made the tame park romantic. I reclined then April's haze immediately behind your slender back and watched your neat small head bend to one side, one palm with fingers spread between a star of trillium and a stone. Pressed on the turf, a little flying bone kept twitching. Then you turned and offered me a thimble of bright metallic tea. Your profile has not changed, the glistening teeth biting the careful lip, the shade beneath the eye from the long lashes, the peach down rimming the cheekbone, the dark silky brown of hair brushed up from the temple and from nape, the very naked neck, the Persian shape of nose and eyebrow. You kept it all, and on still nights we hear the waterfall. Come and be worshipped, come and be caressed, my dark Vanessa, crimson barred, my blessed, my admiral butterfly, explain, how could you, in the gloam of lilac lane, have let uncouth, hysterical John Shade blubber your face and ear and shoulder blade? We had been married 40 years at least, 4,000 times your pillow had been creased by our two heads, 400,000 times the tall clock with the hoarse Westminster chimes has marked our common hour. How many more free calendars shall grace the kitchen door? I love you when we were standing on the lawn, peering at something in the tree. It's gone, it was small, it might come back. All this voice in a whisper softer than a kiss. I love you when you call me to admire a jet pink trail above the sunset fire. I love you when you're humming as you pack a suitcase or the farcical car sack with a round trip zipper. And I love you most when, with a pensive nod, you greet her ghost and hold her first toy in your palm. Or look at a postcard from her, found in a book. She might have been you, me, or some quaint blend. Nature chose me so as to wench and rend your heart and mine. At first we'd smile and say, all little girls are plump, or Jim McVeigh, the family occultist, will cure you that slight squint in no time. And later, she'll be quite pretty, you know, and trying to assuage. The swelling torment, that's the awkward age. She should take riding lessons, you would say, your eyes and mine not meeting. She should play tennis or badminton. Less starch, more fruit. She may not be a beauty, but she's cute. It was no use, no use, the prize is won. In French and history, no doubt, were fun. At Christmas parties, games were rough, no doubt. Then one shy little guest might be left out. But let's be fair, while children of her age were cast as elves and fairies on the stage, that she'd help paint for the school pantomime, my gentle girl appeared as Mother Time, a bent chairwoman with slop pail and broom, and like a fool I sobbed in the men's room. Another winter was scraped, scooped away, the toothwort white haunted our woods in May. Summer was power mode and autumn burned, alas the dingy signet never turned, into a wood duck and again your voice, but this is prejudice, you should rejoice, that she is innocent, why overstress the physical, she wants to look a mess. Merchants have written some resplendent books. Lovemaking is not everything. good looks are not that indispensable. And still old Pan would call from every painted hill, and still the demons over pity spoke, no lips would shed lipstick over smoke. The telephone that rang before a ball, every 2 minutes in St. Rosa Hall, for her would never ring, and with a great screeching of tires on gravel to the gate, out of the lacquered light, a white scarfed bow, would never come for her, she'd never go. A dream of gauze and jasmine to that dance we sent her through a chateau in France. And she returned in tears, with new defeats, new miseries. On days when all the streets of College Town led to the game, she'd sit on the library steps and read or knit. Mostly alone she'd be, or with that nice, frail roommate, now a nun, and once or twice with a Korean boy who took my course. She had strange fears, strange fantasies, strange force of character, as though she spent 3 nights investigating certain sounds and lights in an old barn. She twisted words, pot, top, spider, riddips, and power was red wop. She called you a didactic katydid, and hardly ever smiled, and when she did, it was a sign of pain. She criticized ferociously our projects, and with eyes expressionless sit on her tumbled bed, spreading her swollen feet, scratching her head, with psoriatic fingernails and moan, murmuring dreadful words in monotone. She was my darling, difficult, morose, but still my darling. You remember those almost unruffled evenings when we played mahjong, or she tried on your furs, which made her almost fetching, and the mirror smiled. The lights were merciful, the shadows mild. Sometimes I'd help her with a Latin text, or she'd be reading in her bedroom next to my fluorescent lair, and you would be in your own study, twice removed from me. And I would hear both voices now and then. Mother, what's Grimpen? What is that? Grim Pen. Pause in your guarded solium. Then again, Mother, what's Tritonic? That too you'd explain appending. Would you like a tangerine? No, yes, what does sempiternal mean? You'd hesitate and lustily I'd roar the answer from my desk to the closed door. It does not matter what it was she read, some phony modern poem that she said, in English lit to be a document, and gaze and compelling. What this meant, nobody cared. The point is that the three chambers, then bound by you and her and me, now form a triptych, or a three-act play, in which portrayed events forever stay. I think she always nursed a small mad hope. I'd recently finished my book on Pope. Jane Dean, my typist, offered her one day to meet Pete Dean, a cousin, Jane's fiancé. We'd then take all of them in her new car, a score of miles to a Hawaiian bar. The boy was picked up at 15:15. I didn't know why, sleep glazed the roads at last. They found the place when suddenly Pete Dean, clutching his brow, exclaimed that he had clean forgotten an appointment with a chum who landed in jail if he, Pete, did not come. Etc. She'd said she understood. After he'd gone, the three young people stood before the azure entrance for a while. Puddles were neon barred, and with a smile, she said she'd be de trop. She'd much prefer just going home. Her friends escorted her to the bus stop and left, but she, instead of riding home, got off at Lookinhead. You scrutinized your wrist. It's 8:15, and here time forked. I'll turn it on. The screen in its blank broth evolved a lifelike blur in music world. He took one look at her and shot a death ray at well-meaning Jane. A male hand traced from Florida to Maine, the curving arrows of alien wars. You said that later a quartet of boors, two writers and two critics, would debate the cause of poetry on Channel 8. A nif came pirouetting under white rotating petals in a vernal rite, to kneel before an altar in a wood where various articles of toilet stood. I went upstairs and read a galley proof, and heard the wind roll marbles on the roof, see the blind beggar dance, the cripple sing, as unmistakably the golden ring of its preposterous age. Then came your call, my tender mockingbird, up from the hall. I was in time to overhear brief fame and have a cup of tea with you. My name was mentioned twice, as usual, just behind one oozy footstep, Frost. Sure you don't mind? I'll catch the extant plane, because you know, if I don't come by midnight with the dough. And there was a kind of travelogue. A host narrator took us through the fog of a March night where headlights from afar approached and grew like a dilating star to the green indigo and tawny sea, which we had visited in 33, 9 months before her birth. Now it was all pepper and salt, and hardly could recall that first long ramble, the relentless light, the flock of sails, one blue among the white, clashed queerly with the sea, and two were red. The man in the old blazer, crumbling bread, the crowding gulls insufferably loud, and one dark pigeon waddling in the crowd. Was that the phone you listened at the door? Nothing. Picked up the program from the floor. More headlights in the fog. There was no sense in window rubbing, only some white fence and the reflector poles passed by unmasked. Are we quite sure she's acting right, you asked? It's technically a blind date, of course. Well, shall we try the preview of Remorse? And we allowed, in all tranquility, the famous film to spread its charmed marquee. The famous face flowed in, fair and inane, the parted lips, the swimming eyes, the grain of beauty on the cheek, odd gallicism, and the soft form dissolving in the prism of corporate desire. I think she said, I'll get off here, it's only lock and head. Yes, that's okay, gripping the stang, she peered at ghostly trees. Bus stopped, bus disappeared. Thunder above the jungle? No, not that. Pat Pink, her guest. Anti-atomic chat. 11 struck, you sighed. Well, I'm afraid there's nothing else of interest. You played network roulette. The dial turned and tricked. Commercials were beheaded. Faces flicked. An open mouth in mid-sung was struck out. An imbecile with sideburns was about to use his gun. But you were much too quick. A jovial negro raised his trumpet and tricked. Your ruby ring made life and laid the law. I'll switch it off. And as life snapped, we saw a pinhead light dwindle and die in black. Infinity. Out of his lakeside shack, a watchman, Father Time, all gray and bent, emerged with his uneasy dog and went along the reedy bank. He came too late. You gently yawned and stacked away your plate. We heard the wind. We heard it rush and throw twigs at the windowpane. Phone ringing? No. I helped you with the dishes. The tall clock kept on demolishing young root to old rock. Midnight, you said. What's midnight to the young? And suddenly a festive blaze was flung. Across five cedar trunks, snow patches showed, and a patrol car on our bumpy road came to a crunching stop. Retake, retake. People have thought she tried to cross the lake at Lock and Neck, where zesty skaters crossed from X to Y on days of special frost. Others suppose she might have lost her way by turning left from Bridge Road, and some say she took her poor young life. I know, you know. It was a night of thaw, a night of blow, with great excitement in the air. Black Spring stood just around the corner, shivering, in the wet starlight and on the wet ground. The lake lay in the mist, its ice half drowned. A blurry shape stepped off the reedy bank into a crackling, gulping swamp, and sank. Lif, lifeless tree, your great maybe, Rabelais, the grand potato, IPHLA, Institute of Preparation, for the hereafter, or if, as we called it, big if, engaged me for one term to speak on death, to lecture on the worm, wrote President McGaber. You and I, and she, there a mere tot, moved from New Y to New Shade in another higher state. I love great mountains from the iron gate of the ramshackle house we rented there. One saw a snowy form so far, so fair, that one could only fetch a sigh as if it might assist assimilation. IPH was a lavorium and a violet, a grave in reason's early spring, and yet it missed the gist of the whole thing. It missed, but mostly interest the preterist, for we die every day, oblivion thrives, not on dry thigh bones, but on blood-ripe lives. And our best yesterdays are now foul piles of crumpled names, phone numbers and fox files. I'm ready to become a floweret, or a fat fly, but never to forget. And I'll turn down eternity unless that melancholy and the tenderness of mortal life, the passion and the pain, the claret taillight of that dwindling plane off Hesperus, your gesture of dismay, on running out of cigarettes, the way you smile at dogs, the trail of silver slime, snail's leave or flagstones, this good ink, this rhyme, this index card, this slender rubber band, which always forms when dropped in ampersand, are found in heaven by the newly dead, stored in its strongholds through the years. Instead, the Institute assumed it might be wise not to expect too much of paradise. What if there's nobody to say hello to the newcomer? No reception, no indoctrination. What if you were tossed into a boundless void, your bearings lost, your spirit stripped and utterly alone, your task unfinished, your despair unknown, your body just beginning to putrescate, anon undressable in mourning dress, your widow lying prone on a dim bed, herself a blur in your dissolving head. While snubbing gods, including the Big G, IPH borrowed some peripheral debris from mystic visions, and it offered tips, the amber spectacles for life's eclipse, and not to panic when you're made a ghost. Sidle and slide, choose a smooth surd and coast, meet solid bodies and glissade right through, or let a person circulate through you. How to locate in blackness with a gasp, terror the fair, an orbital of jasp. How to keep sane in the spiral types of space, precautions to be taken in the case of freak reincarnation. What to do on suddenly discovering that you are now a young and vulnerable toad, plump in the middle of a busy road, or a bear cub beneath a burning pine, or a book mite in a revived divine. Time means succession and succession change, hence timelessness is bound to disarrange schedules of sentiment. We give advice to widower. He had been married twice. He meets his wives, both loved, both loving, both jealous of one another. Time means growth, and growth means nothing in Elysian life. Fondling a chainless child, the flax-haired wife grieves on the brink of her member pond, full of a dreamy sky, and also blonde, but with a touch of tawny in the shade, feet up, knees clasped on a stone balustrade. The other sits and raises a moist gaze toward the blue impenetrable haze. How to begin? Which first to kiss? What toy to give the babe? Does that small silent boy know of the head-on crash which on a wild March night killed both the mother and the child? And she, the second love, with instep bear and ballerina black, why does she wear the earrings from the other's jeweled case? And why does she avert her fierce young face? For as we know from dreams, it is so hard to speak our dear dead. They disregard our apprehension, queasiness and shame, the awful sense that they're not quite the same. And our school chum killed in a distant war is not surprised to see us at his door, and in a blend of jauntiness and gloom, points at the puddles in his basement room. But who can teach the thoughts we should roll call when morning finds us marching to the wall, under the stage direction of some goon, political, some ununiformed baboon? We'll think of matters only known to us, empires of rhyme, indies of calculus. Listen to distant cocks crow, and discern upon the rough gray wall a rare wall fern. And while our royal hands are being tied, taunt our inferiors, cheerfully deride, dedicated imbeciles and spit into their eyes just for the fun of it. Nor can one help the exile, the old man, dying in a motel with the loud fan revolving in the torrid prairie night. And from the outside, bits of colored light, reaching his bed like dark hands from the past, offering gems, and death is coming fast. He suffocates and conjures in two tongues, the nebulae dilating in his lungs. A wrench, a rift, that's all one can foresee. Maybe one finds Le Grand Néant, maybe again one spirals from the tuber's eye. As you remarked the last time I went by the Institute, I really could not tell the difference between this place and hell. We heard cremationist guffaw and snort at Graberman's announcing the retort as detrimental to the birth of wraiths. We all avoided criticizing faiths. The great star over blue reviewed the role. Planets had played as landfalls of the soul. The fate of beasts were pondered. A Chinese descanted on the etiquette at teas with ancestors and how far up to go. I tore apart the fantasies of Poe and dealt with childhood memories of strange nacreous gleams beyond the adult's range. Among our auditors were a young priest, an old communist. IPH could at least compete with the churches and the party line. In later years, it started to decline. Buddhism took root, a medium smuggled in, pale jellies and a floating mandolin. Fra Karamazov, mumbling his inept, all is allowed into some class's crypt, and to fulfill the fish wish of the womb, a school of Freudians headed for the tomb. That tasteless venture helped me in a way. I learned what to ignore in my survey of death's abyss. And when we lost her child, I knew there would be nothing. No self-styled spirit would touch a keyboard of dry wood to rap out her pet name. No phantom would rise gracefully to welcome you and me in the dark garden near the shagbark tree. What is that finding creaking, do you hear? It is a shutter on the stairs, my dear. If you're not sleeping, let's turn on the light. I hate that wind. Let's play some chess, all right. I'm sure it's not the shutter. There, again, it is a tendril fingering the pane. What glided down the roof and made that thud? It is old winter tumbling in the mud. And what now shall I do? My knight is pinned. Who rides so late in the night and the wind? It is the writer's grief. It is the wild March wind. It is the father with his child. Later came minutes, hours, whole days at last, when she'd absent from her thoughts so fast. Did life the woolly caterpillar run? We went to Italy, sprawled in the sun on a white beach with other pink or brown Americans. Flew back to our small town, found that my bunch of essays, The Untamed Seahorse, was universally acclaimed. It sold 300 copies in 1 year. Again, school started, and on hillsides where, round distant roads, one saw the steady stream of car lights all returning to the dream, college education. He went on translating it to French, Norvell, and Don. It was a year of tempest. Hurricane Lalata swept from Florida to Maine. Mars glowed, Shaw's married, gloomy Russian spied. Lang made your portrait, and one night I died. The Crawshaw Club had paid me to discuss why poetry is meaningful to us. I gave my sermon, a dull thing but short, as I was leaving in some haste to thwart the so-called question period at the end. One of those peevish people who attend such talks only to say they disagree stood up and pointed with his pipe at me. And then it happened, the attack, the trance. But what a mild fits. There sat by chance a doctor in the front row. At his feet, patly I fell. My hearts were stopped to beat, it seems, and several moments passed before it heaved and went on trudging to a more conclusive destination. Give me now your full attention. I can't tell you how I knew, but I did know that I had crossed the border. Everything I loved was lost, but no aorta could report regret. A son of rubber was convulsed and set, and blood-black nothingness began to spin. A system of cells interlinked within, cells interlinked within, cells interlinked within one stem, and dreadfully distinct against the dark, a tall white fountain played. I realized, of course, that it was made not of our atoms, that the sense behind the scene was not our sense. In life, the mind of any man is quick to recognize natural shams, and then, before his eyes, the reed becomes a bird, the knobby twig, an inchworm, and the cobra head, a big, wickedly folded moth. But in the case of my white fountain, what it did replace perceptually was something that, I felt, could be grasped only by whoever dwelt in the strange world where I was a mere stray. And presently, I saw it melt away. Though still unconscious, I was back on Earth. The tale I provoked my doctor's mirth. He doubted very much that in the state he found me in, one could hallucinate or dream in any sense, later perhaps, but not during the actual collapse, no, Mr. Shade. But doctor, I was dead. He smiled, not quite, just half a shade, he said, however I demurred. In mind, I kept replaying the whole thing. Again, I stepped down from the platform and felt strange and hot and saw the chap stand up and toppled, not because a heckler pointed with his pipe, but probably because the time was ripe for just a bump and wobble on the part, or a limp limp in old unstable heart. My vision reeked with truth. It had the tone, the quiddity, and quaintness of its own reality. It was. As time went on, a constant vertical in triumph shone. Often, when troubled by the outer glare of street and strife, inward I turn, and there in the background of my soul stood Old Faithful. And its presence always would console me wonderfully. Then, one day, I came across what seemed a twin display. It was a story in a magazine about a Mrs. Z whose heart had been rubbed back to life by a prompt surgeon's hand. She told her interview of the land beyond the veil, and the account contained a hint of angels, and a glint of stained windows, and some soft music, and a choice of hymnal items, and her mother's voice. But at the end, she mentioned a remote landscape, a hazy orchard. And I quote, "Beyond that orchard, though, a kind of smoke, I glimpsed a tall white fountain and awoke. If on some nameless island Captain Smith sees a new animal and captures it, and if a little later Captain Smith brings back a skin, that island is no myth. Our fountain was a signpost and a mark objectively enduring in the dark, strong as a bone, substantial as a tooth, and almost vulgar in its robust truth." The article was by Jim Coates. To Jim forthwith I wrote, got her address from him, drove west 300 miles to talk to her, arrived, was met by an impassioned purr, saw that blue hair, those freckled hands, that rapt, orchideous hair, and knew that I was trapped. Who'd miss the opportunity to meet a poet so distinguished? It was sweet of me to come. I desperately tried to ask my questions. They were brushed aside. Perhaps some other time the journalist still had her scribblings. I should not insist. She plied me with a fruitcake, turning it all into an idiotic social call. I can't believe she said that it is you. I love your poem in the Blue Review, that one about Mont Blanc. I have a niece who climbed the Matterhorn, the other piece I could not understand, I mean the sense. Because of course the sound, but I'm so dense. She was, I might have persevered. It might have been more to tell her about the White Fountain, we both had seen beyond the veil. But if, I thought, I mentioned that detail, she'd pounce upon it as if upon the frond affinity, a sacramental bond, uniting mystically her and me, and in a jiffy our two souls would be brother and sister trembling on the brink of tender incest. Well, I said, I think it's getting late. I also called on Coates. He was afraid he had mislaid her notes. He took his article from a steel file. It's accurate, I have not changed her style. There's one misprint, not that it matters much. Mountain, not fountain. The majestic touch. Life everlasting, based on a misprint. I mused as I drove homeward, take the hint, and stop investigating my abyss. But all at once it dawned on me that this was the real point, the contrapuntal theme. Just this, not text, but texture. Not the dream, but topsy-turvical coincidence. Not flimsy nonsense, but a web of sense. Yes, it sufficed that I in life could find some kind of link and bobo link, some kind of correlated pattern in the game, flexed artistry, and something of the same pleasure in it as they who played it found. It did not matter who they were, no sound, no furtive light came from their involute abode, but there they were, aloof and mute, playing a game of worlds, promating pawns to ivory unicorns and ebon fawns, kindling a life here, extinguishing a short one there, killing a Balkan king, causing a chunk of ice formed on a high-flying airplane to plummet from the sky and strike a farmer dead, hiding my keys, glasses, or pipe, coordinating these events and objects with remote events and vanished objects, making ornaments of accidents and possibilities. Storm-coated, I strode in. Sybil, it is my firm conviction. Darling, shut the door. Have a nice trip. Splendid. But what is more, I have returned and convinced that I can group my way to some, yes dear, faint hope. Now I shall spy on beauty as none has spied on it yet. Now I shall cry out as none has cried out. Now I shall try what none has tried. Now I shall do what none has done. In speaking of this wonderful machine, I'm puzzled by the difference between two methods of composing. A, the kind which goes on solely in the poet's mind, attesting of performing words while he is soaping a third time one leg, and B, the other kind, much more decorous when he's in his study writing with a pen. In method B, the hand supports the thought. The abstract battle is concretely fought. The pen stops in midair, then swoops to bar a canceled sunset or restore a star, and thus it physically guides the phrase toward faint daylight through the inky maze. But method A is agony. The brain is soon enclosed in a steel cap of pain. A muse and overalls direct the drill, which grinds and which no effort of the will can interrupt, while the automaton is taking off what he has just put on, or walking briskly to the corner store to buy the paper he has read before. Why is it so? Is it perhaps because in penless work there is no pen pose to pause, and one must use three hands at the same time, having to choose the necessary rhyme, hold the completed line before one's eyes, and keep in mind all the preceding tries? Or is the process deeper with no desk to prop the false and hoist the poetesque? For there are most mysterious moments when too wary to delete, I drop my pen, I ambulate, and by some mute command, the right word flutes and perches on my hand. The best time is in the morning, my preferred season, midsummer. I once overheard myself awakening while half of me still slept in bed. I tore my spirit free and caught up with myself upon the lawn, where clover leaves cupped the topaz of dawn, where shade stood in night's shirt and one shoe. And then I realized that this half too was fast asleep. Both laughed and I awoke, safe in my bed as day its eggshell broke, and robins walked and stopped, and on the damp gem turf of brown shoe lay my secret stamp, the shade impressed, the mystery inborn. Mirages, Miracles, and Midsummer Morn. Since my biographer may be too staid, or know too little to affirm that Shade shaved in his bath, here goes. He fixed a sort of hinge and screw affair, a steel support running across the tub to hold in place, the shaving mirror right before his face, and with his toe renewing tap warmth, he'd sit like a king there, and like Marat bleed. The more I weigh, the less secure my skin. In places it's ridiculously thin, thus near the mouth, the space between its wick, and my grimace invites the wicked nick. Or this dewlap, some day I must set free, the Newport frilla inveterate in me. My Adam's apple is a prickly pear, now I shall speak of evil in despair as none has spoken. 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 strokes are not enough. 10, I palpate through strawberry and cream the gory mess, and find unchanged that patch of prickliness. I have my doubts about the one-armed bloke who in commercials with one gliding stroke clears a smooth path of fresh from ear to chin, then wipes his face and fondly tries his skin. I'm in the class of fussy feminists, as a discreet effeb in tights assist, a female in an acrobatic dance, my left hand helps and holds and shifts its stance. Now I shall speak. Better than any soap is the sensation for which poets hope, when inspiration and its icy blaze, the sudden image, the immediate phrase, over the skin a triple ripple send, making the little hairs all stand on end, as in the enlarged animated scheme of whiskers mode when held up by our cream. Now I shall speak of evil as none has spoken before. I loathe such things as jazz, the white-horsed moron, torturing a black bull, rayed with red, abstractist, bric-a-brac, primitivist folk mask, progressive schools, music and supermarkets, swimming pools, brutes, boors, class-conscious, Philistines, Freud, Marx, fake thinkers, puffed-up poets, frauds and sharks, and while the safety blade would scrape and squeak, travels across the country over my cheek, cars on the highway pass and up the street, incline, big trucks around my jawbone creep, and now, a silent liner docks, and now sunglasses toward Beirut. And now I plow old Zemblo's fields where my gray stubble grows, and slaves make hay beneath my mouth and nose. Man's life is commentary to abstruse, unfinished poem note for further use. Dressing in all the rooms, I rhyme and roam throughout the house with, in my fist, a comb, or a shoehorn, which turns into the spoon I eat my egg with. In the afternoon, you drive me to library. We dine at 6:30, and that odd muse of mine, my receptacle, is with me everywhere, in car, in my chair. And all the time, and all the time, my love, you two are there beneath the word, above the syllable to underscore and stress the vital rhythm. One heard a woman's dress, rustle in days of yore. I often caught the sound and sense of your approaching thought. And all in you is youth, and you make new by quoting the old things I made for you. Dim Gulf was my first book, free verse. Night Road came next, then Heeb's Cup, my final float in that damp carnival. For now I turn, everything poems and no longer squirm. But this transparent thingum does require some moondrop title. Help me, Will. Hail fire. Gently the day has passed in a sustained low hum of harmony. The brain is drained in a browning note, and the noun I meant to use but did not dry on the cement. Maybe my sensual love for the consomme des pois echoes for a child is based upon a feeling of fantastically planned, rich-rimmed life. I feel I understand existence, or at least a minute part of my existence, only through my art, in terms of combinational delight. And if my private universe scans right, so does the verse of Galaxies Divine, which I suspect is an iambic line. I'm reasonably sure that we survive and that my darling somewhere is alive, as I am reasonably sure that I shall wake at 6 tomorrow, on July the 22nd, 1959, and that the day will probably be fine, so this alarm clock, let me set myself, yawn, and poke back Shade's poems on their shelf. But it's not bedtime yet. The sun attains old Dr. Sutton's last two window panes. The man must be, what, 80, 82? Was twice my age the year I married you. Where are you? In the garden? I can see part of the shadow near the shagbark tree. Somewhere horseshoes are being tossed. Quick clunk, lean against its lamppost like a drunk. A dark Vanessa with a crimson band wheels in the low sun, settles on the sand, and shows its ink-blue wingtips flecked with white, and through the flowing shade and ebbing light, A man unheedful of the butterfly, some neighbor's gardener, I guess, goes by, trundling an empty barrow up the lane.